Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our service this morning. We trust that we will enjoy and appreciate the presence of the Lord as he's with us this morning. God has been so good, and in all his goodness to us, we rejoice in what he does for us. Ascribe to the Lord, almighty ones, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders, and the Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The voice of the Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. Rejoice in the Lord always. Lord, we come into your presence this morning and we thank you that you are an incredible God. You are majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, and we just praise you because you continue to work wonders. You never change. You're always the same, yesterday, today, and forever. And so as we come into your presence this morning to worship you, we want to honor and glorify you. We want to see ourselves. We want to see our Savior. And we want your name and your word to live in us. And we'll be careful to give you the glory and the honor and praise, for we dare not touch your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take our hymnals now and turn to hymn number 37. Hymn number 37. The Lord spoke all these words, and he said, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself any idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations to those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. You shall not take it in vain. For the Lord your God will hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days shall you labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath day. Keep it as unto the Lord. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your manservant, nor your maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. May the Lord bless the reading of his word to our hearts. Lord, we come to you this morning, and as we read your laws, we realize that we have offended and we have broken your laws. But we are so thankful this morning for your grace which covers us. You told us that you would meet us at the mercy seat. And there, above the broken law, we find the mercy and the grace and the love of our wonderful Lord who went to Calvary on our behalf. Thank you that you paid the price for our sins. And that when we come to you in faith, that you will forgive our sins and cleanse us and make us whole. And we will be clothed with the righteousness of Jesus Christ our Lord. That we can stand before you blameless and holy, children of God. And we thank you for this. And Lord, we come to you this morning and we just praise you that you are such an awesome God. That you have redeemed us and you have given us a hope of the future. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Take our hymnals again and turn to page number 8. Are there any special requests that you would like to share with God's people this morning? Anybody in particular need, family or friends? Yes. Okay, let's remember to pray for their friend with having brain surgery. Anyone else? Okay, let's pray. Let's have a moment of prayer first, remembering loved ones, family, and friends that have particular needs that you weren't able to mention, and then we'll pray together. We come before you this morning, Lord, not because of our goodness or our own righteousness, but because of who you are. We pray that you would give us a sense of humility as we come before you, but a sense of exuberance and joy as we realize that you are still King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that nothing, no kingdom, no nation, no ruler can usurp your authority, but that everything is still under your control. May we live in the joy of your presence, and may we honor your name. And Lord, we bring to you this morning our request. We think of this one up in Traverse City that will be having surgery this week. Lord, that you might bring peace and comfort, give the doctors skillful hands that they might be able to perform the surgery, and if it be your will, raise this person up to complete health and bring them home again, rejoicing in you. We pray for our pastor this morning as he's away. We ask that you would give him a good week and a good time together with his family. And Lord, bring him back to us again next week with a renewed vision and joy in his heart for what you're going to do in this family of believers. Then we think of those of our family and friends who are overseas serving you this morning. We pray, Lord, that some of them, though they're lonely, that they might sense your presence and that you would lift their spirits in joy and praise and honor and give them a fruitful ministry. May we not forget them as we support them in our prayers. We think of our families this morning, children and grandchildren and some great-grandchildren. Lord, that you might speak to them and continue to draw them to yourself, that you might be honored and glorified in their lives. And Lord, for those of us who have had burdens this week, we pray that we might leave them here this morning in your capable hands. And those that go on their way rejoicing, that others would rejoice with us. And Lord, we pray now that you would speak to us in this service, that your name would be honored and glorified. For we pray in the powerful name of our soon coming King Jesus. Amen. Let's take our hymnals again and turn to hymn number 42. Hymn number 42. If you have your Bibles and you would like to turn to it, we're looking at Proverbs chapter 30. There are three things that are too amazing for me. Four that I do not understand. The way of an eagle in the sky, the way of a snake on a rock, the way of a ship on high seas, and the way of a man with a maiden. And then from Isaiah, but they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. When I was in high school in Nigeria, I was walking home from the school. We had 4 miles. I had stayed late for some kind of practice, probably soccer. And I was jogging along, and I came into this valley. And as I entered the valley, I saw an eagle flying diagonally across the valley. Well, somewhere along that flight path, he got into crow territory. And these crows felt that he was going to invade their nest, so they started to attack him. They came at him from the top, and the eagle simply turned over and turned his talons to the crows. So they backed off. And then he kept flying. And so they came from the bottom, and they tried to attack him from the bottom. And he just kept flying. And all across the valley, that eagle kept flying in a straight line right across the valley. And the crows were bombarding him and everything, but they didn't touch him. Thus began my fascination with crows. He never lost his focus. He never lost his direction. He never lost his purpose. Don't know where he's going, don't know why. But I got thinking about it, you know, maybe that's what God was talking about. And so as I looked at the scriptures, I began to see references to eagles, and I thought, wow, that's pretty neat that God talks about us as eagles. Now, in Isaiah's passage, we find out if you want to be born an eagle, if you want to fly like an eagle, you got to be born like an eagle. Whoops, maybe the... Oh, thank you. And so the first thing about an eagle is if you're going to fly like an eagle, you got to be born an eagle. Isn't that kind of what Jesus was saying to Nicodemus when he came that night? And Nicodemus said, how can I get into the kingdom of God? Verily, verily, I say unto you, you must be born again. You must be born from above. You must have a spiritual rebirth as you become an eagle. Nicodemus, I'm telling you this, and Nicodemus says, wait a minute, I'm an old man. How can I enter again into my mother's body and be born again? And Jesus said, well, it's a spiritual birth. Look at the wind. You can't see it, but you can see what it does. You don't know where it comes from or where it's going, but you know it's there. Nicodemus, I'm telling you the truth. If you want to enter God's kingdom, you must be born again. I think of a little boy. He had a fascination with ships. How many of y'all have gone and seen the tall ships? Have any of you seen those? Yeah, a couple of you. Yeah, sure. Can you imagine crossing the ocean in one of those things? Anyway, this little boy was really fascinated with ships. And he went into the store one day, and there in a hardware store, they had a model of a ship. And he said, I want to buy that. So he went home, and he told his dad, he says, I want to buy that model. And so his dad said, well, I'll help you. Well, you can work all summer. I'll give you jobs. You can work for the neighbors. The kid collected tin cans, and he sold them. And he mowed the lawn. He did the dishes. He cleaned out the barn. He did everything he could till he had enough money by the end of the summer that he bought that boat. All winter long, he worked on that boat. His dad helped him put the little pieces together and helped him paint it. And finally, when spring came and the ice thawed, his boat was ready to sail, all painted and looking really good. So he ran down to the creek and he put the boat in the water. And unbeknownst to him, there had been a storm up river. And on that flood water, it carried his boat away. He ran alongside of the river trying to get his boat back, and he couldn't get it back. And finally, he sat down and cried because his boat went over the falls and disappeared. A couple weeks later, he was back in the hardware store in town. And there was his boat right in the front window. So I went to the owner of the store, and he said, hey, that boat's mine. That's mine. You can't sell it to somebody else. And the owner says, no. He says, I find it, finders keepers. The little boy burst in tears. Went home and he told his dad, he said, man, he said, that guy's going to sell my boat to somebody else. So he worked all summer. Once again, he sold tin cans and he mowed the lawn and he did the dishes and did all kinds of odd jobs for the neighbors. And just as false weather started to move in, every week he'd go back to the store and he checked that his boat was still there. But finally he had enough money and he went and he bought his boat. And he's walking out the store and his dad heard him say, boat. Boat, you're mine. You're mine twice. You're mine because I made you, and you're mine because I bought you. Isn't that what Jesus was saying to us in Romans? In that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. For one reason, so that we could be redeemed. And when we're redeemed, we're born as eagles. Now, the second thing about an eagle, he builds his nest. Now, the kind of eagles that fascinate me are not the ones that that just build any old place. You know, there's some eagles in English. Like the eagles that they don't build clear up on top of the cliff. They don't build down low, because if they built down low, other animals could get them from below. And if they built right on top, other animals could get them from on top. So they build in places that are really inaccessible to anybody else. And they build their nest. This nest offers security to them. But it does a lot more than that. You know, as you look at it, you stop and you think, this nest here is so that people can't attack it. Other animals, other birds. They wouldn't dare attack the eagle's nest. There's a security in that. And God's word tells us that, no, in all things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Is there anything that can take us away out of his hand? No. Not death or life or angels or principalities or powers or nakedness or famine or sword or any problem that you'll ever meet can snatch you out of his hand when you're in his nest. You know, when I was a kid, we used to have to sail overseas. Some of you with missionary families and relatives probably remember them talking about that. Boy, that was a long trip. You'd sail from New York or Montreal, or once we sailed from Texas. Actually, I crossed the ocean 5 times on an ocean liner. And these are not small vessels. The Queen Elizabeth or the Queen Mary, I forget, Queen Elizabeth, I think, is 1/4 mile from stem to stern. So these are big ships. And each category of people had their section of the ship where they stayed, and we were in the cabin class, and then there's the first class. But my sister and I found doors and secret ways that we could get all over the ship. I mean, we explored everything. We got in more trouble. I mean, we had a good time. But I remember one time we were sailing on the Oriole, and we got across, and we were sailing, I think it was through the Bay of Biscay, which is one of the roughest sea spots in the world, one of the roughest bays in the world, and a storm hit. Now, I don't mean a storm. I mean a storm. You know, I mean the kind of storm where they tip the cables on your chairs in the dining hall, and they screwed them into the floor so that your chair wouldn't go. And then they wet down the tablecloth, a kind of a bummer, because I liked it. The ship would roll this way, and I get a bite of Dad's steak, and it rolled this way, and I get a bite of Mom's steak. You know. And finally, they ended up putting boards around the table. Of course, by that time, a lot of people were sick and weren't showing up for meals anyway. But then they put sand down the aisleways in the ship for obvious reasons. And people were sick all over the place. Well, I wasn't sick. I was kind of... You know, Mom and Dad, they'd go out and they'd hang on tight, and they kept trying to get me to go up on the top deck and get some fresh air. Do you all remember those suckers that they used to have that had a sucker and then there was a stick in it and it looped down around and went back up into it? Anybody remember those? Okay, I was laying in my bunk bed, top bunk, sucking one of those suckers, just enjoying life, and the ship would roll this way and I'd bunk against the bulkhead and it'd roll against that way and I'd bulk against the railing. And then it rolled one big time. And it rolled back, and I slammed up against the bulkhead, and I swallowed that sucker whole. I mean, it went down, and I felt it hit bottom. And I thought, oh, my goodness, I'm going to die. And it was terrible. And then I got sick. And I got real sick. And Dad kept saying, come on, let's go get some fresh air. No, I don't feel like getting some fresh air. I'm sick. Night came. All through the night, the storm raged. In the morning, I noticed that I wasn't slamming against the railing or the bulkhead. So I decided to go up with Dad. And we went up on the top deck, and we discovered that generations before, out in the ocean, these people had piled rocks way out in the ocean. And the wave would hit the rock, and it would break it up, and only the top half would go over. And then they go a little bit farther, maybe a quarter of a mile, and bam, hit another set of rocks. There were 3 rows of rocks until the wave was broken down Now, the storm was still out at sea, but we weren't rocking anymore. We were safe. We were in harbor. And I kind of figure that that's what Jesus is talking about. You've got a home, a safety, a security in Christ that is unshakable. Have you ever thanked God for that? Well, I have lots of times. You know, there's a guy that built his house on the rock and a guy that built his house on the sand and the storm came. Listen, it's the same storm for everybody. Just because we're Christians doesn't mean we're not going to face financial loss or sickness or death of a loved one. Or we're not going to have problems with kids and grandkids and great-grandkids and the whole tribe. But there is that security of knowing what direction you're flying. Okay, let's go to the next one. Okay, now, when it's time for them to learn to fly, this fascinates me. And by the way, if you will, Exodus 19, verse 4. Well, let's go to Deuteronomy first. Like an eagle that stirs up its nest and hoovers over its young, that spreads its wings to catch them and carries them on its pinions. What's he talking about? Or in Exodus 19, 4. God says to the children of Israel, I carried you on eagle's wings. Isaiah 41, he says, I'm doing the same thing for you. I'm carrying you on my wings. Now, we were born to fly, but little eagles don't know how to fly. And so there comes a time when the mom and the dad, eagle, scatter the nest. Okay? I can kind of picture myself if I was in that nest. And I see mom and dad over there pushing parts of the nest off the cliff. And they push the nest off the cliff, and I would go to the farthest part of the cliff, away from the edge, and I would say, whoa, wait a minute, what's going to happen here? They're taking away my security. They're taking away my home. They're taking away everything I know. And finally, there's nothing left of the nest, and I get pushed off. The parent eagle shoves the little eaglet off the cliff, and he starts to fall. Now, I don't know about you, but I'd be screaming all the way down, Mommy, Daddy, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that to me. Just before the little eaglet hits the ground, the parent eagle swoops underneath them, gets them on their back, and flies them back up to the rock where the nest used to be. And then guess what? He does it all again. Shoves them off again. Until finally the little eagle catches on. You gotta fly! And he starts flapping his wings. And he learns to fly. You know, when God shoves you off the cliff, he's not abandoning you. He's not shoving you off so that you'll self-destruct on the rocks below. He's teaching you how to fly. And some of the difficulties that you face, and some of the issues and the problems that you face, or that I face, are God's process of refining us so that we can learn to fly like an eagle. Wait on the Lord. Renew your strength. Mount up with wings as eagles. Run and not be weary. I was standing on the top of Mount Bentimani, one of the highest points in West Africa. And I looked down out across the vista below me, and I saw an eagle, and he was circling, never flapped his wings. I thought, what's going on? And I watched. I stood there for probably 10, 15 minutes and just watched this eagle as he circled through the valley, going higher and higher. And next thing I knew, I was looking up, saying, wow. That's what God wants us to do. That's what God wants you to do. That's what God wants me to do. Now, unfortunately, some of us will say, well, I can't fly anymore. I have a broken wing. And I can't fly anymore. For the next couple minutes, I want you to think about God's people in the scriptures who had broken wings. Abraham. Boy, he had horns in his halo, didn't he? What about him and Hagar? Come on. Here we are, thousands of years later, still suffering from that time when Abraham broke his wing. Moses, oh my, what a violent temper. killed that Egyptian. Twice later, he kind of let loose. Did Moses fly? You know what? He was more to the children of Israel than Abraham and George Washington. Abraham Lincoln and George Washington combined have been to America. He had a broken wing. David. Uh-oh. And Bathsheba. Uh-oh. Did David have a broken wing? Yeah. Why is he called a man after God's own heart? Because he learned to repent. And he learned that God can fix broken wings. Peter. How could Peter stand up in front of the church when he knew that everybody there knew that he had denied Jesus? Talk about a broken wing. But what happened to Peter? He was filled with the Holy Spirit till all men could see Christ only always living in Peter. Paul. Boy. How would you like to know Paul before his conversion? You get beat up. Get thrown in jail. You might even be killed because Paul was adamant that this is not the way. He had a broken wing. But one day he met Jesus and it changed all that. Jesus fixed that broken wing. And Paul wrote a majority of the New Testament, filled with the Spirit, till Paul could say, I've learned to fly. Now, we think, well, that all sounds good. I remember when Seth, our grandson, overseas, on the Bible school compound, you're not supposed to shoot birds. But the little African boys have their slingshots, and they can't resist on the Bible school compound because we have an orchard, and we have a swamp, and we have all kinds of, we have forest. And it's a good place to hunt for birds. And every once in a while, they'll be lucky enough to hit one. Well, they broke one's wing. It was a lovebird. And they broke its wings, and they were playing with it. And Seth didn't like how they were playing with it. And so he came back in and got enough money from his parents, and he went out and he bought this lovebird with a broken wing. He took care of that little bird. And about 6 weeks later, the wing was mended, and he let it loose, and it flew off. About two or three times a week after that, Seth has a guava tree right outside the bedroom window. And that little bird would come and sit in that guava tree in the afternoon, mid-afternoon, two or three times a week. And it'd sit there for about 10 minutes and just chirp and chirp and chirp and chirp and chirp and chirp. And Seth said, Grandpa, he's telling me thank you. Now, when God mends our broken wings, we need to be thankful. It should humble us. It should help us to realize who we are. But it should make us totally aware of his awesome, incredible glory that he can forgive. And he can take our sins as far as the east is from the west. Now, keep in mind, Paul and Peter and them, they never denied that they'd had a broken wing. You know, sometimes the devil comes to us and he hammers us. And he wants us to say, you can't fly. You can't fly. What makes you think you can fly? Well, because, see, I've been born again. And God has mended my wing. And I can fly by his Spirit. You know, isn't that an awesome truth? Let's go to the next one. Now, an eagle would much prefer to eat live than dead. He'd much rather go after something live, a rabbit, a squirrel, a chipmunk, a fish, than he would a roadkill. I mean, come on. And so he thrives on capturing what's really good for him. You know, when I came to the States during the war, the war took place and we were evacuated from Sierra Leone. And I got to the States and I felt, boy, we're not going to be able to go back. And so I became a pastor of a little church. And one of the things that I did is I found four pastors that I really admired and appreciated, and I asked them to help mentor me, because in the 20 years that I've been out of America, things have changed. And so I went to them and asked them for help. And in the process, one of the books that I read told me that the number one reason for pastor dropouts in America was pornography. And I thought, man, they're eating roadkills. God wants us to eat the live, vibrant, dynamic food. That's why he said to Joshua, "This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, and then you shall have good success, and your way will be prosperous, and you'll learn to fly." "Your word," David said, "your word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against you." During the war, we fled across the border into the neighboring country. And during that process, when I'd go back and set up my base camp there, and I'd go for about 6 weeks at a time, then I'd come home for 6 weeks and back like that. On one of those times, I shared a home with a pastor, and he had an extra room, and a visiting pastor. Now, this visiting pastor was not too sharp. He had no common sense. I remember when he went to Bible school, and I was on furlough, and I went back, and here he is. He's a Bible school student. And I went to the principal of Bible school, and I said, "How'd he get in here?" "Well, he applied, and the church recommended him." I said, "Why?" "Well, he went all through Bible school, and he passed." And later on, by the way, I taught him theological education by extension courses. I think he aced every course, but he had no practical sense. One morning, he came in, and he had stayed that night, and early in the morning, just as the sun came up, I heard somebody singing, "Good morning, Jesus." I won't sing it because I can't sing, but "Good morning, Jesus. Good morning, Lord. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Lord." Now, this guy had been captured by the rebels 2 times. The first time, he escaped on his own. The second time, they came to me and they said, "Hey, you got to buy him back." I said, "What do you mean, buy him back?" He said, "Well, the rebels have caught him and they're taking him away. You got to go buy him. He's one of our pastors." So I bought him back. Interestingly enough, about 6 months later, they came to me and they said, "Hey, you need to buy Stephen a wife." I said, "What?" "Oh, yeah, you bought him back from the rebels, and now he needs a wife, so you need to pay the dowry for him to have a wife." I said, "Nah, it's not going to work that way." But anyway, here he is, sitting there in the morning. "Good morning, Jesus. Good morning, Lord." And then he began to pray. And that guy took me into the throne room of the Heavenly Father. He prayed in Karanka. He prayed the scripture back to his Heavenly Father. Then he prayed in Creole, and he prayed the scripture back to his Heavenly Father. And I thought, you know what? That's why God's using him. We were arrested in a town 12 miles from there. And I thought of him. The longest I've ever heard him preach was probably about 15 minutes. But when he got done preaching, the Muslims walked away, and they said, "You know, that made sense. That made sense." No common sense, not a real practical person, hard worker, great guy, but when he talks about Jesus, it makes sense because he had learned to fly. And filled with his spirit, he continues to pastor a church, and he continues to share the love of Jesus, and he doesn't care who you are, he's going to tell you about Jesus. You see, we've got to feed on God's word. We've got to have it anchored in our hearts and in our souls. This book of the law shall not depart out of our mouths. Okay, we got to feed on live things. And as the eagle flies, he soars. Now, there's something else that I learned about eagles, and this really fascinated me. In the Smithsonian Institute of Science, and I quote, let's go to the next picture, okay? He's flying along, and finally there comes a time when our eagle, it's time for our eagle to die. Can we have the next picture, please? Can hardly see that. He's sitting on a cliff there. Can you see him? Okay. They have a picture of an eagle. Well, I think he's stuffed, actually. And he's sitting on a cliff in the Smithsonian Institute in Washington. And underneath, there's a brass plaque. And the plaque says, when an eagle has a premonition of death, it leaves its nest, it flies to a rock, it fastens its talons to the edge of the rock, and looks straight into the setting sun, and then it dies. End of quote. Have you ever seen an eagle die? I think Timothy saw one. Paul. He said, Timothy, I've fought the good fight. I've finished the course. I've run the race. And now there's laid out for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to all who believe in him. And not only to me, but to everyone who believes in him. And Timothy watched as an eagle went home to glory. Claire and I saw an eagle die. Well, we weren't there at her death. She was a missionary nurse in Sierra Leone. Good nurse. They were in the tribe next to us. Closest white neighbors to where I lived. 60 miles away, took us about 4 hours, sometimes 6 hours to get there, depending on the season of the year. She was a good nurse. And her husband labored there for 8 years. And during the last portion of that time, she kept reoccurring getting sick. And we all thought it was reoccurring malaria. And they came home on furlough and found out she had MS. And she couldn't return. They could not return to Sierra Leone. So God took this nurse off the field and brought her to America. And she became a prayer warrior, a serious prayer warrior. The last 9 years of her life, she spent in a wheelchair. She couldn't do anything. Her husband had loaded her into the van, and one day they loaded in a van, and I think the straps broke or something, and she fell in the back of the van and broke both legs. She never complained. But she's a prayer warrior. Things kept getting worse, and finally, this past summer, God called her home to glory. I remember talking with them. When she was in college, she was dating Stan from... They were going to two separate colleges. She was in nurse's training, and he was at Taylor University. And one night, she called Stan, and she was crying. And Stan said, what's the matter, Valley? And through her tears, she cried, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Stan, Jesus loves me. And an eagle began to fly. She came home and she's in a wheelchair. Now, I don't know about you, but that would be hard. 9 years as her body slowly deteriorated. And one day she said, you know, Jesus loves me, and I love Jesus, and I belong to him. So if he wants to do something with me, he can do anything he wants with my body. An eagle was flying. You see, sometimes we want to be where everybody can see us. And we want the accolades, and we want the applause, and we want to be noticed. But God says, trust me. Just like you trusted me when I pushed you off the edge. And you learn to fly. Trust me. Trust me. And so Valley flew. And at her memorial service, we were all humbled by the fact that we had been in the presence of someone who had learned to fly. You see, God has a purpose for you. And his purpose is that you fly. In order to do that, you must be born again. Then you build a nest, not in your own strength, but in his strength. And you let his Holy Spirit flow through you. and he shoves you off the cliff, and he takes you through trials, takes you through temptations. But you know what? The God of the mountain is still God in the valley. The God of the day is still God in the darkest night. And he can take you, and you can soar on heights way above the mountains. Not that anybody will see you, because by then you won't care. Because anything he wants to do with me, I'll let him. Because I'll trust him completely. Dear Jesus, sometimes it's hard. But you didn't promise an easy road. You just promised that you'd always be there with us. You didn't promise that when we went off the cliff, that we wouldn't be scared. But you promised that you'd be there and carry us on your wings till we learn to fly. And so we pray this morning, Lord, that you would speak to us. And there's some here that have broken wings. And they've said, I can't fly. Help them to go with that confidence that you can heal that broken wing, that you can forgive them, that you can still instill in their hearts the power of the Holy Spirit, and they can soar the heights once again by your incredible grace and phenomenal mercy. You are an awesome God. Thank you, Jesus, what you're going to do. Amen. Let's take our hymnals. All good and perfect gifts come down from the Father above, in whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. And so we return a portion of those gifts to you and ask your rich blessing on them. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for all your rich blessings. Thank you for all you've done for us. And now, bless these gifts and each giver, we pray, in Jesus' name. This morning, there may be somebody who says, I can't fly as an eagle because I've never been born as an eagle. We'd like you to talk to a friend. I'd be available. Talk to one of the elders, one of the board members. Talk to somebody who knows Jesus and have them help you be born from above. Or maybe you have a broken wing and you say, I've been telling myself I can't fly. God's not telling you that. So go to a friend and pray together and let him heal you completely. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. May the Lord turn towards you and be gracious unto you and bless you throughout this coming week as you endeavor to fly and lift up Jesus' name for the glory, honor, and praise of our soon coming King. Amen.